Hello and welcome to another episode of The Circularists, and I am delighted to welcome my guest this week, which is Keshoe Isaiah from Kenya, from the Maasai tribe, and you are a Maasai warrior. We want to hear all about this. And what's perhaps less known is that the Maasai tribe are guardians of the earth and pioneers of protecting and sustainability and so on. So Keshoe, welcome. I would like to hand the floor to you to do your own introduction, because you are so many things and you're so active in the climate space. Please introduce yourself. Tell us about you, your work, your world.
Okay, thank you so much, Karen Adam, for having me on this platform on the other episode of The Secularist. I'm so glad to be here and wow. I'm so happy. And I champion for climate change and also indigenous advocacy here in Kenya. I'm from the Maasai community here, and my community advocate for wildlife conservation and also nature, and the culture between my community creates the intimacy between the culture and also the conservation. And I'm so glad to be here today and also expressing how the indigenous knowledge coincides with conservancy, and also how the indigenous knowledge helps people in Kenya to also protect the environment.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. So I see that you're wearing red, and I've seen some images of yeah. jumping and the Maasai tribe. Can you tell us, what does this symbolize? What does it mean for you?
Yeah, the red shukas, or for, here in Kenya we call it red shukas, or this is our attire that we usually wear, and also it was our attire since the memorial period and all that, even our great-grandfather used to wear. And also the red attire symbolizes it symbolizes bravery and also victory. So it symbolizes victory and also bravery.
So it symbolizes victory and bravery. Okay.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
So the picture that we jump is during the ceremonies, and that's where we usually celebrate while jumping, and also it happens occasionally during ceremonies and also festival. Yeah, so jumping is a sign of happiness, and also it's a sign of victory, the sign of it's a sign of winning. So my community embrace a lot when it comes to wildlife and also conservation and also culture. Mm. And the strong culture connects people with nature. So jumping is a sign of victory, and also it's a sign of manhood, yeah, such kind of thing.
Right. I'm gonna pause here and show a clip. Show me you're in love. Tell me I'm enough. It's been hard to trust in you, trust in your time. So do you think that your tribe will celebrate and jump for victory when the world changes its stance towards the environment and the destructive nature and relationship that we currently have with it? Do you see a victory jump, maybe reverberating around the whole world? Maybe we should all wear red for victory and jump when we get to that place.
Yeah, definitely no. Yeah, because it's just, I don't know whether you guys have been following. Most of the time, these communities face a lot of eviction, especially from their ancestral lands. Mm. Most of the time, they face evictions and they're being forced to move out of their land. And just because of some reasons, or just because of some exploitations. So having that moment, I think it's always a sad moment for us. And mm-hmm. also because we really protect land and we value our ancestral land so much. Mm-hmm. And also we value the biodiversity in it. So I don't think when there's this destruction and also the impacts of climate change, it's so hard for us to persevere, since we're at the front line of all this catastrophes. So it's so hard for us to maybe, I think that moment is going to be the worst moment in my community, because most of the time, I think you see like these local communities, there are people who are always cool in their places. So you would never find them maybe walking out of going to urban areas and also going to even maybe trying to do something in urban areas and also trying to maybe do something that is not going to help them. But you try to see that companies and all that that comes to maybe make some exploitation in their areas. So you find that for them, they don't even need to, that it's a community that they don't need much. They only need land for their livestock. They only need a place to preserve their culture and also a place to live. Yeah.
So they're living peacefully with the land, in harmony with the land, and are protectors, but are being evicted and oppressed by the surrounding world.
Right?
And who's protecting them? They're protecting the land. Who has got their back? Who's protecting them? No one?
We have the leadership in my community, and those leadership positions safeguard the community, especially when it's come to land ownership and also culture, because during those days, I can say that maybe 50 years ago, we used to have a strong leadership before even the government was adopted and all that, before Kenya and even Africa used to have that. So this community used to have a strong leadership. Right. So you find that the leadership around the community is so strong, and they respect such kind of leaders.
Wonderful.
Yeah. So finding such kind of leaders, they take roles in maybe holding ceremonies, making clans meetings and all that, and also making sure that the community are being safeguarded. And also, if you go to where these local communities are, if you even want to take a project site now, the first people you have to approach are the, in Kenya, we call them Wazewa Vijiji. Wazewa Vijiji means that we have those people who are above the community, who safeguard the community.
Okay.
So there's a strong pillar of leadership in it.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I want to touch on something that we spoke about earlier, Keshoe. So you are on the front line of climate change. You're seeing the earliest impacts with flooding and other catastrophes to do with the weather. In your own words, please tell us in a moment, but what I want to hear from you again is the fact that you managed to pursue your education and to get out into the world and to travel to conventions and to where people are gathering around the world talking about climate change and what we must do next. But many in your community were forced out of education permanently. Can you just tell us in your own words, have I paraphrased that correctly? And can you tell us in your own words exactly what happened there?
Yeah, as I told you yesterday, my community is at the front line of the climate crisis, and you find that the climate has affected most of the parts, different aspects. You find education, health, and even social life is being affected. And most of the time, this community even doesn't understand that how to do or how to go about this this scenario. And you find most of the time, they are losing a lot, especially when it's come to maybe their livelihood is being affected, and also what they depend on is livestock and all that they're being affected. So you get a lot of information that maybe the climate crisis is affecting a lot, and also maybe their livelihood is being affected, and also education system is being affected. As I told you, most of the people drop out of school because migration happens. So sometimes they have to move with their livestock, maybe moving from one area to another. And then moving that time, the patterns change, the education system's patterns change. Maybe, for example, you have to move from one place to another to maybe migrate with their livestock and all that. And then coming back to school, maybe someone has even grown, has become maybe over age, maybe now starting school is going to be difficult for you. So that's how the education system is being affected. I can say the climate refugees has caused all those in education. So as a climate activist, for maybe I've gone to various conferences and even I've gone to various conventions and also interacted with different people from different parts of the world. Mm-hmm. Yeah, climate education has been a pillar for me also to support and also try to educate my community and also try to show them that we have to do this. We have to do adaptation. We have to do resilient projects. We have to know that we are on the front end of the climate crisis and we have to do this and we have to try to find ways for us to even live with our livestock and also make our livelihood stand out.
So in terms of your education, you were one of the few lucky ones, fortunate ones that were able to pursue your education. So did you major in, did you study climate change, sustainability science? What was your area of study that helped you or was compatible with moving into climate advocacy?
Yeah, I can say when I joined college, I didn't even know more about maybe studying climate change and all that. So climate change just came by passion.
Okay.
So when I joined college, I then pursued something else differently from even climate change.
Right.
So yeah, I can say climate change and even environmentalism in me, mm-hmm. or even the conservation. Mm-hmm. I had it before even coming to school because we used to graze our livestock around the game reserve places and also having wildlife around you every now and then, having the four big forests around you, having all these ecosystems around you. Mm. So you had that passion to embrace the system around you.
Yes.
So that's where I gained the passion and also I love nature and also conservation and even wildlife. So I don't think I'm pursuing something concerning environment, or maybe particularly I was just saying when I finish my college, I'll pursue maybe a further education concerning what I'm passionate about. Yeah. Mm.
So, yeah. In an earlier introductory video of the Circularists, I asked a question, who does this? And what that meant was who wakes up in the morning and decides I'm going to the front line of the fight to save humanity from the worst impacts of climate change. So you are one of those people who woke up and thought, I need to be involved, I need to be part of this. What I'm hearing from you is you attribute that to your proximity to nature, to livestock, to the land. And then you also mentioned something about your culture. So respect for the land, not plundering it, is built into the Maasai way of life, if I understood that correctly. Can you tell us a bit more about that? Is this correct as I've framed that?
Yeah. Yeah, you find that the culture holds a lot when it comes to nature. And also we have some cultural belief that you don't have to cut these trees. We don't have to do this about, you don't have to destroy the forest. You don't have to do this. So some cultural are being supported by nature. And also the culture, we stand that we have to hold this. And also the belief that we have is that we have to conserve the environment. We don't have to cut the trees. And the indigenous knowledge is a pillar of conservation because you find most of the time, even the medicine that we use to treat ourselves are from the forest. And even the plants that we use to maybe build our shelter are from the forest and also. And even most of the time, the animals have to eat what is in the forest because most of the time you find when the drought comes, we migrate to our livestock, and the first place that we migrate are we go to stay in the forest with the livestock so that we can have something for them to eat. Mm-hmm. And sometimes even predicting weathers and all that, we have some plants that we usually see are concerning indigenous knowledge, and you just know that this plant predict that we have a drought season soon.
Oh,
and
really?
This plant predict that we have a rainy season soon. So I think it's contributes a lot in terms of biodiversity protection.
So what I'm hearing is your environment, you've got such respect for your environment. There are trees that you know not to cut, not to harm. You take medicine from your local environment. The local environment is educating and teaching you and telling you what the long-term weather forecast is going to be because of what grows when. So you can predict droughts coming because of what you see growing around you. Is that what you just said?
Yeah.
It's so amazing. So, you know, you've grown up with this relationship to the land that I haven't grown up with. I haven't grown up with that awareness. I mean, I've always had this affinity with nature and what it gives me, but because, you know, I'm living in a largely concrete environment and the society doesn't really instill in us this respect. It's a case of if it grows, it's potentially a free resource for me to plunder and monetize and get a profit from. That's the psyche, I think, that I've been raised within. But you're in two, I guess you straddle two value systems, right? You've grown up in this very respectful environment with nature, but then you also have to be part of this modern world that we live in. So you straddle both of those value systems, I think, right? How do you navigate that? How do you make sense of the world?
Yeah, it's so hard because most of the time, maybe you have to move from the village and go into the city. Mm-hmm. And also maybe if you go to the city, you find most of the people, they do a lot of pollution. And most of the time you see like, even that's where you hear a lot of news. Maybe you, because you get access maybe to internet and all that, mm-hmm. Maybe you can watch a video, someone else is destroying a forest. Mm-hmm. Then it's so hard for you to even try to digest and also trying to think about it. Because maybe, for example, you come from a place whereby you have been consuming the forest and all that, and maybe the biodiversity is being protected. Then now you come to a place whereby people are ignorant. They don't want to know about this. They just have profit over people. They don't care about whether you're living in a good environment or not. So I think it has been a very high challenge for me. And that's where my activism started. And also, it has also steered me in terms of activism, and also in terms of mobilizing young people around Kenya so that we can fight for it. And also, we can also stand out to fight for our species, because most of the time you find such pieces are being destroyed, and bringing them back is so hard. Bring them back is so hard. Because even most of the time, you see, like these communities, like my community, the Maasai, they protect a lot of species, biodiversity species. Mm. But now, if you come and cut the forest down, these people, they don't have that climate education. They don't know. They don't know about tree planting. They don't know about such kind of thing. Mm. For them, they have just been protecting an indigenous forest since then. So from you coming from nowhere, coming to cut the forest down and destroying all the trees, so for them, they don't have that climate education. They don't know how circular economy works. They don't know how plastic pollution works. Mm. So they don't know such kind of thing. So when you come to destroy the indigenous forest that has been there for a long time, so it's going to be difficult for them to also start again doing reforestation and also bringing back the forest again.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So yeah, it has been a very big challenge for them also, the local communities. In fact, they face a lot because. So that's where the gap is, that we're trying to educate them and also trying to steer climate education so that they can also regenerate the land that has been lost about, because most of the time they don't know how they can bring back this land again or maybe restore again the species after being maybe destroyed by maybe exploiters of all.
Right. So you're actively involved in this re-education or this education of how to recover and repair and replant their land. Is that right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So, Keshoe, in terms of your activism, can you give us a guided tour around all the projects that you're involved in? What does your activism look like? You've mentioned the indigenous, the education with replanting, you've mentioned youth. Can you just talk us around all of your activism and where it takes you, what you do?
First of all, when I joined college, I volunteered in most of the organizations. I joined many organizations in Kenya, and then I also joined global movements like Fridays for Future, Kenya Chapter, and also I joined various clubs in my college that advocate for environment. And that's where I supported my passion, and also I gained knowledge, and also I learned a lot from various people I networked, and also I went also to most of the capacity building. That's where I gained a lot of experience to also run my projects and also make sure that I also impact the local communities, and also trying to inspire young people from my village also to also take care of the environment. Mm-hmm. And from that moment, when I formed my network initiative that focuses on indigenous people, because I saw that there's a big gap in terms of indigenous communities, because most of the time they don't have their voices. So I try to bring them together so that we can amplify their voices even internationally and even right. in Kenya. So activism has been so just been so tough also, because you need also to balance what you're doing maybe, and also trying to do the other thing. So, and also mobilizing people together is so tough also. Mm-hmm. And making sure that these people understand all this, it has been also difficult for us, because most of the time you find in our local communities, people are never going to school. So you have to use the other language to translate to them so that you can see, you can tell them that you have to do this, this is how things go. Mm-hmm. And then you also have to get a translator, you be the translator, maybe for example, to translate to them that this thing is done this way, because for them, they have never gone to school. Even our parents, even my parents, they have not gone to school. I'd have to talk to them in Maasai language to tell them that this is going to be done, we have to do this. Mm-hmm. So I think it has been the best experience, because I enjoy doing, because it's my passion, and also trying to inspire young people to take action to protect the planet in various movements.
Wonderful.
And also, I've also learned a lot. Yeah.
Wonderful. So you say that you are about raising voices, lesser heard or unheard voices. What would those voices want to say? So through this platform, through this Circularist interview, what sorts of things would those voices want the whole world to hear? What would they want to say? You know, what's challenging? What can, you know, what help is needed? What do they want to say?
Yeah, first of all, you find that for those people who are hard in the spaces, the first thing, they do a lot in terms of climate action on the grassroots level. They do a lot of adaptation projects. They do a lot of maybe resilience projects. And most of the time, these people are just doing grassroots community projects. And maybe, for example, sometimes they don't even get access to social media platform. They don't get access to internet, maybe, for example. But now getting young people who are passionate and even know such kind of information, and they know how to gather information, and they know even to make even a way to come even maybe in some of the platforms like LinkedIn. So it is a better position, and also is the best way for us even to post and also see what we are doing, and also trying also to impact those who are behind us, the young people, so that they can also be doing what we have been doing. So mm-hmm. I think it has been so wonderful, and also maybe encouraging them has been the best way to also inspire them to take actions. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. I hope that we can speak again, Keshoe. And maybe you can bring some guests and allow people to just speak through the Circularist channel to the world, yeah. to my network, about what they're doing, thinking and feeling, to share stories. Because I think we can inspire one another if we share, and if we're aware of what's going on in all corners of the world and on the front line. I think it's really important. I'm so thrilled that you joined me. I'm honoured that you took the time to speak to me. I hope we can speak again and update on your journey at a future date. Is there anything that you'd like to say in the final 2-3 minutes that we have?
Yeah, thank you so much, the Circularists, and thank you for having me here and also being among the Circularists today. I'm so glad to be here. And what I want to pass the message to every person who is listening to this, that we have to make these voices to be heard, and also make sure that the young people in the global south and also in all parts of the world, we pave a way for them, and also make sure that we have them on such kind of platform. And also for the local communities and indigenous community, let's respect the indigenous knowledge, because they do a lot on the grassroots level, and also they can serve a lot of information regarding nature and also ecosystem. And let's always aspire to learn from them and always make them come to this platform. And I'm looking forward to bringing more people from the Global South and also youth who have been doing an amazing work behind me and also together with me. And I'm so glad to be here. Thank you so much.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Keshoe. See you again.
See you. Thank you so much.